Well, if you recall from the last lesson, the last video, 2x plus 7 is the oblique asymptote for that synthetic or that long division that we did, and we said that we discarded the remainder because, of course, the remainder was of lower order than x squared minus 4x plus 3, which we were using for division. The this video will try to answer why. Why is it that we discard the remainder even though it contains an x term inside it? So it poses an interesting question. Now in the last video, just to be on the safe side, we divided the denominator into the numerator of the rational function. 2x cubed minus x squared minus 5x minus 2 was being divided by the polynomial x squared minus 4x plus 3. And we obtained the line 2x plus 7, but then we had this remainder. The remainder could be expressed as a fraction, as another rational function, 17x minus 23 divided by x squared minus 4x plus 3. And as we saw, when all we did was enter 2x plus 7 as our line, we got a line and it seemed to behave quite convincingly as an asymptote, except for that little bit of behavior in the middle. That behavior in the middle, of course, notice that one part goes up to positive infinity as x approaches positive 1 from the right and down to negative infinity as you approach plus 3 from the left. Now, in the last video, we just had this situation, and the only problem is we want to seek an answer to why discard this rational function. Isn't it important? And does it have anything to, does it affect our line? And we will find out that actually it doesn't affect the line at all. And in fact, we can simply go with 2x plus 7 as our linear asymptote and lose no information in terms of what the oblique asymptote is, or what we call the slant asymptote. Now, when x is small, that is when x is in between those two vertical asymptotes, between x equals 3 and x equals positive 1, the behavior is a little different. You don't notice any kind of tendency toward any kind of linear asymptote. To be sure, it looks as though the function is actually going towards positive infinity as x approaches positive 1 from the right, and toward negative infinity as it approaches negative 1 from the left. And notice those, if you factor the bottom of that remainder, x squared minus 4x plus 3, you actually get two distinct factors. Those two distinct factors just so happen to be the vertical asymptotes themselves. The vertical asymptotes, of course, being x equals 3 and x equals 1. Now, these are for r of x, which affects the horizontal asymptote in a sense. And remember what r of x is. Here's r of x, the rational function itself. You might even want to pause the video there to remember what that was. But as we were saying, the oblique asymptote is actually crossed when x is between 1 and 3, not including 1 and 3 itself, because of course r of x is actually undefined at x equals 1 and x equals 3 because they are vertical asymptotes. I do, however, have a little mistake in the video where I say x greater than or equal to 1 and less than or equal to 3, but it's not allowed to be equal. But of course, in between those two numbers, somewhere that oblique asymptote is crossed, and that certainly remains to be true. Now, things change when x gets large. When x gets very, very big, 2x plus 7 of course dominates, and I'll show you how it dominates. For one thing, let's just look at 2x plus 7 by itself and take its limit as x goes to infinity. And if you recall what a limit is, as far as we're concerned in advanced functions, we just think of a really, really big number and substitute it for x if we're thinking of x going to infinity. So I'm going to choose a million, or 10 to the sixth. This results in 2,000,007 as the result, and I think you and I can agree that that's pretty much on its way to positive infinity. Now, as the limit, as x goes to negative infinity, as for that limit of the same 2x plus 7, we're going to see a similar behavior, except that it's going toward negative infinity. Now, what about the rational part of that asymptote expression? What's happening to that? Well, let's take its limit and let's try to see what happens if it could influence its value. Obviously, if the limit as x goes to infinity happens to be some distinct number, we'd want to know about it. So let's let it go to positive infinity. That means, just as before, we're going to substitute 10 to the sixth, or 1 million, for x. And we're going to subtract 23. That's, you know, subbing in for a million. And on the bottom, a million has to be squared for the x squared term, and then subtract 4 times a million plus 3. As you can see, the first term, 10 to the sixth all squared, is going to completely dominate the denominator. In fact, it's going to completely dominate that whole expression. So, and that's because the bottom is increasing much faster, much, much faster, due to the x squared term, as x gets very, very large, either very, very negative or very, very positive. So this is like saying that this is a lot like 17 times a million, or 17 million divided by 10 to the 12, which is approximately equal to, really, if we allow cancellation, and again we're being very approximate here, but it's not too bad, 17 over 10 to the 6. I did say 10 to the 12, that was a mistake. But either way, I think we can agree that's a very, very small number, very close to zero. Now, as the limit as x goes to negative infinity, you're going to find also that that limit will equal zero as x gets very, very negative. So, as x gets large, the remainder plays less of a role in the linear asymptote, or sorry, the oblique asymptote. The oblique asymptote, or the line part of the oblique asymptote, plays a dominant role and actually can be considered to be the asymptote itself.